built a PWA for Ola. So I'm excited to share my experiences that I had while building those PWA at JS Food today. So the first thing that comes to anybody's mind when you have to build a new website is, which framework are we going to choose this time? So I think is it good? So at Ola, we were interested in, we were very much concerned with the building a highly performant application for low-end mobile devices which are running on a low 3G network. So we considered a couple of frameworks. So first was Angular and then was React. So Angular was a framework where our entire team was very comfortable with, but it had some problems in terms of rendering large lists. It had problems with the digest loops. So we thought about React. React was a very good framework, you know, with its one-way data flow and its virtual DOM library. But then Angular 2 came out, which had one-way data flow and two-way data binding between its components. So we went ahead and built a POC. So, and then we measured the performance and we found out that it required a 30 KB polyfill, around 198 KB of framework and associated libraries, and about 50 KB of just a POC application. So, and also the rendering performance was really poor on a mobile device. So next we wanted something lighter. So we went ahead with Vue and Polymer. So Vue and Polymer were very similar in terms of their development style and even their performance characteristics. But Polymer was based out of web components and it had a slightly edge over Vue.js. So that is why we chose Polymer. So what is Polymer? Polymer is a JavaScript library where you can create your own web components. That's it. It's just a wrapper around web components. So it basically gives you a syntactic sugar around web components. It provides you a data system. So basically it allows you to declare variables and bind it to the template. It also gives you an event system which allows you to communicate up the element, custom element tree. So why did we choose Polymer? Obviously, it was because we needed a performant framework for the mobile, but also because it was based on web components and it had shadow DOM. Lazy register was a feature that we utilized fully. So let me tell you what lazy register is. I would define some element somewhere along my anywhere in my application, and I would import it much later, but it wouldn't break the application. And the best thing is, once the application was, once the custom element definition is downloaded, it would then instantiate all those references that I did beforehand. So that was a feature that allowed me to utilize this over GA, Google Analytics tags. So basically I included them with my top level component Ola app, and then I would import it long later, because I didn't want to hurt my first paint time. So finally there it was. It was a collection of 88 reusable components. And Polymer being a library for web components, it didn't have any specific guidelines for building a PWA. So we at Ola, we created our own guideline. So we went with props down and events up model and used Redux to store data that is shared between the various components. Polymer also provided us a way wherein a child could reflect values back to its parent. But this was a pattern that we specifically didn't use. But we used two-way data binding within the data within a single component so that we didn't have to do any DOM manipulations manually. So Polymer provides you things like a DOM if and etc. DOM if and DOM repeat. So let's see how Polymer helped us in performance. The first thing was Shadow DOM. Shadow DOMs scoped CSS and isolated DOM obviously provided us a lot of performance benefit. But I'm not going to talk much on that part. That is very obvious. But I just want to highlight a small problem that we faced while using Shadow DOM. So this is the only caveat that you should probably keep in your mind before using Shadow DOM. So I was using ReCapture.js and found out that it is not compatible when it is included inside your Shadow DOM. So what was happening was ReCapture.js was, whenever I used to try to say that I'm not a robot, it was not recognizing it. So I had to find a workaround and get it working. So the only thing is, the problem for me here was I couldn't rewrite the ReCapture.js on my own, right? It is a third party service. If it was any other third party library, I probably would have, we would have written it in-house. So that maybe if you're using a third party library, you should just keep in mind and probably build a POC before you try it out. Polymer CLI is a tooling that Polymer comes with, which helps you create either an element repository or a single page application. So I'll walk through some of the features and I'll tell about what are the enhancements we made on that. Polymer JSON is an input wherein is an input file wherein I can define my entry point, my app shell and my routes. It also allows me to prepare my production build wherein I can define how do I want to compile it, like, you know, minification, uglification, etc. Or you could use the best practices presets that Polymer recommends. So you could generate something like ES6 unbundled, wherein you would create a dist of ES6 and it is unbundled, and also simultaneously create a ES5 distribution with bundled. All of this comes out of the box. You don't have to write any configurations for this. Now, let's say you wrote a PWA. You want to make a PWA, right? You just created a single page application out of Polymer. And now you could just say that, you know, add service worker as true. And you got yourself a PWA. Do you want to make your app purple? Then you just add the push manifest. So once I add service worker, I would also have to give it SW precache and runtime configurations for it. So at Ola, we precached all of our index.html and all of our 88 web components. And when it came to runtime caching, there was only one API we could cache it, because Ola, being a highly transactional and real-time application which provides cab service, it was not possible for us to leverage runtime cache on any other APIs. And of course we used it to, you know, like, cache the images, which is a no-brainer. So this is the Ola offline experience that we have, wherein you can book a cab via SMS. So this page kicks in anytime you have a poor bandwidth connection. So this is the most innovative thing probably Polymer introduced: distribution of unbundled code. So have you ever heard of, you know, without doing anything, you're just shipping code? So that is what we did actually. Here you can see that all my web components are distributed individually over HTTP2. Doing this gave me a freedom that if I updated a particular component, let's say which is of around let's say Ola app, which is around 6.3 KB, only that would be updated on the next service worker update. Otherwise, rest of the components are untouched, which probably doesn't happen when you bundle the code all together. Polymer also provides you a programmatic hook wherein you can do, where it provides you a callback where you can hook certain functions after next render. So basically this allows that, says that, you know, you are, it gives your browser a breathing space so that all the painting is done and you can do some, schedule some JavaScript tasks. So basically we use that to do the lazy loading. So over here you can see that we, at first what we did was we just lazy loaded all of the components. So it, some components were loaded at the beginning and then everything was lazy loaded. And I can show you that over here the content download for one of the component was 1 second. And this was a relatively important component for the page and it was actually creating a block in our parsing. So what we did was we thought, let's, you know, let's get crazy and try breaking this lazy load into couple of chunks. And once we did that, we saw that from 1 second it decreased to 100 milliseconds. So that is a 90% increase, 90% improvement in my download time because of my staggered loading. So let me explain how we did our staggered loading. So Ola is basically a location centric company. So location is very important for us to serve you. So we show a model wherein we ask for a user's geolocation permission. So we use this and made sure that whatever was required to paint this would be rendered greedily. We don't make any delay. As soon as the index.html is served, we make request to download this. Next, whatever comes after the click of this, any user action that comes after this will be downloaded later. And in the next cycle, I will make sure that whatever is required for the home page is downloaded. And finally, those pages which are generating as a click out of those first page are downloaded in the final cycle. So that is why it was we called it ahead of time staggered loading. Next, we measured performance after all this and we were doing pretty well in service worker supported browsers and we were actually doing well in Safari as well, but its Safari's repeat load was not at all different from its first load, and we were wondering why, and we dug deeper and we found that since we were not doing versioning on our Polymer components, it was resulting in around 80 plus network calls wherein it just says and asks, am I changed, and says no, you're not. So this created a performance bottleneck for our Safari browser. So what we did was we added file revisioning and added set long expiry cache headers. With this, this enabled us to go a step further. So in our service worker precache, this is how it would look like, and this is how the network precache call would go. So it would basically append a cache busting parameter at the end. So imagine now I have a file revisioning enabled, and when I am doing a precache, service worker is making the request to the same resource which was downloaded couple of seconds ago. Don't you think that was that is a waste? So once with this enabled, we could directly ship the code like this, wherein I didn't have to depend on service worker to burst my cache and I was responsible for managing my own application cache. So this gave us a tremendous performance boost, not only in Safari but also in service worker supported browsers. So we had a couple of more things that we did. So basically our index.html was generated out of an index.pug which had configurations injected into it at runtime. Now the problem, as you can imagine, is that the first time I serve and I precache, index.html is cached. and index.html, it doesn't have its hash written in service worker, because the service worker slash path hash is generated by reading index.pug. So index.pug basically has something like, you know, square bracket and, you know, dot config dot something. And whenever I change my configurations in my Docker, that will not, the service worker has no clue that it has changed. So I thought, what are we going to do about this? Because we wanted config only redeployments. So what we did was, instead of versioning our pre-cache directly as, you know, v1, v2, etc., we replaced it with epoch timestamp. So basically this enabled us, you know, to deploy as many times, every time we deployed, service worker would know that there is a update and it would reinstall. So you might think, now because every time you deploy, if you are going to delete service worker and etc., isn't it a overhead? No, not really, because we have file versioning enabled, so that would you know, pick up from the disk cache itself. So that way we are not making an extra network call to fetch the index.html again, but rest of my custom elements are safe in the cache. And with this pattern, we were all RPL. We didn't have push, and we thought, let us introduce push to our application. And we took the help of Cloudflare in our infrastructure to make this happen. So we had measured our performance before. The TTFB, time to first byte, was around 1.7 seconds. But after we added Cloudflare server push, it increased to 3 seconds. So that was around 1.3 seconds performance penalty after introducing push. So we stayed RPL. So if anyone of you guys in the audience have a success story around implementing purple pattern using your infrastructure, please reach out to me after the talk. I would be interested in listening, you know, to the success stories. So now let us have a demo on using a Chrome extension. So basically I was coding in AngularJS, and I was very much used to using Batrang, a Chrome extension which allowed me to inspect the scopes in my application. So whenever I used to do application programming which had a lot of conditionally rendering UI, it helped me debug complex use cases. So Polymer didn't have a support for such feature. So I went ahead and actually built one so that I could debug my applications just as the way I did in Angular. So basically here you can see that there are various conditions that enable and disable certain features in the application. So this basically allows us, so basically this shows the data associated with your Polymer element. So if you are you know, building a Polymer application, then I think this will definitely come to your help. So while measuring performance, we use various tools. I just want to know how many of you guys in the audience have used Lighthouse. That's a good number. And what about web page test? Are you using it actively? I think there are less number of people using web page test. So web page test is a website where there is developer tools integrated, there is even Lighthouse integrated, and it gives you a lot more features over that. I think that is a tool which we all of us should use. And while you are using it, make sure that you test your, you emulate a mobile browser like Moto G4, and also use a network connection called Emerging Markets 3G, which is a benchmark against which we measured our Ola app against. So there it was. We had a application size of around 200 KB, a Lighthouse score of around 100. And our first load time on low 3G network on a Moto G4 phone was 3.4 seconds. And our repeat loads were within 0.4 seconds. So this was the metrics that got us selected for Google I/O. So this was all about how we built PWA at Ola. Now I want to compare and contrast, why would you use basically Polymer. So recently Polymer 2 was released, and it came out with the support for ES6. So before I start with the advantages of Polymer, I'll talk about the disadvantages. Polymer is a lightweight library. Polymer 2 is basically around 10 KB. But if you are using it on unsupported browsers, that would require a polyfill of around up to 28 KB. And if you are concerned about IE support, then there is only IE support above IE11. And it also has some flaky support in UC browser and older versions of Android and web views. And if you're concerned about SEO and also server side rendering, Polymer 2.0 doesn't have support yet. Polymer 3.0 is on its way, and it has support. In the recent Polymer summit, they have announced that they will be supporting server side rendering and other SEO benefits. So now let's come to the advantage. Polymer is a lightweight library of around 10 KB, and because it is using web components, it is the fastest library that you can get in terms of web components. And you saw that it had a very simple data system and event system and a little bit of syntactic sugar. It is very simple. It takes just about a day to learn Polymer. But though it is so simple, it is very powerful, and I am sure that all of our use cases, most of our use cases will be, it is good enough to support most of our use cases. And bye-bye CSS preprocessors. I don't know about you, but I am just glad that I don't have to work on Less or SAS anymore with Shadow DOM enabled. And configurable build. So basically, Polymer build is highly configured, wherein you can create multiple distributions. Like, you can create various bundles wherein using presets, you can even override the presets themselves. And these were the benefits if you're thinking it in terms of a single page application. But it doesn't matter. Even if you want to use it as a standalone web component library, it integrates well with any framework. So if you want to know how many people are using Polymer in production, this is a slide which was presented in Polymer Summit recently. So EA, basically they created a set of customizable UI elements and used it across all their various gaming content websites. Predix, they built a library wherein were created components, and they have successfully integrated with Angular and React. And McDonald's, the menu that you see is actually powered up by, which is actually now powered up by Polymer. And last but not the least, Ola, which built its PWA completely with Polymer. So we got featured in around 7 talks in Google I/O, and also got featured in Polymer Summit. And these are some of the encouraging tweets that we received. That would be all. Thank you.
No, it's not. Okay, let me. Hello. Hello, yeah.
In the first slide, you mentioned that the bundle and unbundled of ES5 and ES6. Can you explain what is that and what bundle it does?
Yeah. You are talking about this slide, is it? Yeah. See, so basically a preset comes with a lot of options. So it basically allows you to minify and uglify your JS. It minifies your CSS. It inline, it minifies your HTML. So basically Polymer CLI also does a sort of dependency graph and creates a distribution file. So you could also create, it analyzes all your packages. So especially when you say bundled, right? So it creates a dependency tree and creates automatic chunks of it. So it would do the chunking for you. Is that, so you have you used Webpack? So basically it creates chunks out of you, chunks for you, right? So something that is common and then some chunks which are associated with the route. So basically bundle does the same thing for you. But the recommendation is using unbundled along with HTTP2 because that gives you a huge performance boost as opposed to using HTTP1 with bundled code.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
So my question is, so you talked about Polymer and a lot of features of PWA web components, etc. So firstly, before Polymer came in, Google was pushing a lot in terms of Angular as a framework. So Polymer seems like a competing technology. What do you think are the key considerations for going, taking Polymer over Angular or other technologies? What is one key consideration that you think? That is number one. Number two, a lot of what you mentioned, PWA, HTTP2, in retrospect, do you think you would reconsider the decision to use Polymer and perhaps, you know, just go with pure web components along with the PWA?
So he asked me two questions. So what was the main consideration for using Polymer? And second one was, would I go use you know, vanilla web components? So to answer that first, so there is a talk by Alex Russell in Chrome Dev Summit last year. So basically what he says is, we don't understand how mobile works. So for a mobile web to be useful, it has to have a very less payload size. It has to, you know, load things in a certain pattern so that it doesn't overwhelm a low-end mobile device using a flaky connection. So that is why we went with Polymer, because that only that had the performance characteristics that we were looking for. So we try, so just to show you something, you can take a look at this actually. So because any framework that is not web component, they have a lot of abstractions above them. So this abstraction translates into downloading that abstraction and then parsing that, and browser also has to process that in runtime, which makes it much more difficult for a mobile browser because it has a very limited CPU as opposed to your desktop CPUs. And to answer your second question, Polymer is basically providing me, like I mentioned in my slide, so it provides me with the syntactic sugar around web components, and it provides me a decent data and event system. So I wouldn't think, you know, unless I don't find any compelling reason to use vanilla web components as such, because this is really a lightweight library around 10 KB if you're using Polymer too. So
more questions?
I used web components using Polymer, but that was back in 2015 when 0.5 version was there. They were not even 1.2, and we actually took the risk of going ahead with a production application for that. For our POC, it was working fine, but as and when the application got complicated, for Chrome, Firefox, it was working well, but on I think we are using 11 at that point, but it was taking 10 seconds to just come up with the initial screen. How is the performance now of IE? Have you tested it on IE?
Yeah. So there is this point, right? So we are concerned with building a performant mobile web experience for mobile. So that is why we could go with Polymer. So we are not concerned with desktop performance as such, because if it is performant on mobile at this level, then its performance in desktop will unquestionably be, you know, similar. So if you are making it work for a Moto G4 on a low 3G end connection, so the performance in non-supported browsers on desktop would definitely be, you know, maybe a little bit degraded, but no, it wouldn't be that bad.